Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our hearing today. This is the Committee on Women, Children, Family Relations and Gender, joint with the Committees on Justice and Human Rights, Science and Technology, and Social Justice, Welfare, and Rural Development. We have quite a number of bills. Some are bills that have passed in the House, and others are bills that are pending both in the House and in the Senate. So what we've done is we've divided them by topics, obviously those that are of identical or very similar subject matters will be heard together. And I will call on the resource persons to speak on each one. Many of you, like DSWD, PCW, will probably speak on all the bills, but the others are here for specific measures. So I will just call on those who we understand are work directly related to the bills that I am about to call. But if you have something to add, feel free, just raise your hands so I take note of you, especially those in the corner because yung eyesight ko medyo ganyan, okay? Not to ignore you, but it's a logistical thing kasi medyo dumami tayo. So on that note, let's start because there's quite a few. And later on today, because it is breastfeeding month, we will have an exhibit on breastfeeding, of which, of course, all of you are welcome. So let's start with the bill on rectification and simulated birth records. We have House Bill number 5729, an act allowing the rectification of simulated birth records and prescribing administrative adoption proceedings. This is all we have, and based on my reading of the measure, it's fairly straightforward. It is a common practice that there have been a lot of cases of simulated births because in the interest of securing, I guess, the physical being of the child and making them as part of one's family, there are quite a number of people who resort to simulated births. So this bill is about rectifying that situation and providing administrative adoption procedures. And it says that provided that the child has been living with the person for at least 5 years. Of course, there's still the case study by the DSWD and some other requirements. So can I hear from DSWD and CWC? And also DOJ and PSA. So let's start with CWC, which is where? CWC, there. Ms. Norma Mojica, your position on this.
Yeah, generally CWC supports this bill. As you earlier said, it would rectify and curtail the simulation of birth. Although 5 years for us to declare may be too long for the child.
Okay. What's your idea?
Well, based on the interview I've done with some of the social workers, but of course I will later on give this to DSW, this is they're the ones on the field. There are times that, like for foster care, it just takes 6 months before placement. So they're saying 5 years may be too long because, you know, even for a shorter period of time, the child can already be with the would-be adoptive parents or whoever simulated the birth. You don't have to wait for 5 years for the child to be with that particular person. And considering the processing of papers, I don't think it would also take 5 years for them to process papers if ever they're going to adopt the child. So.
shorter period. Okay. Let's hear from DSWD. Ms. Yes, Alcabasa.
Yes, ma'am. The DSWD po supports the intention of the bill. Pero yung sa rectification po ng simulated birth, masyado pong matagal yung nirecommend natin. Sa amin, 5 years. Kasi judicial
process... Five.
Kasi judicial process, inirecommend naman judicial process pa rin sana siya. Yung hindi po naman sana sinasama yung adoption proceedings na maging administrative process kasabi ng rectification simulated birth certificate. Dahil, una po, i-discourage nito yung mga regular prospective adoptive parents to go through the regular adoption process. Kasi po sabihin nila na yung mali na nga po yung pag-simulate ng birth certificate tapos sila pa po yung napapadali yung process. Kasi dito po yung case lang po yung simulated birth certificate. So we strongly recommend po na as a part bill be drafted and making adoption proceedings as administrative process rather than judicial. Tapos, including na po.
Adoption process,
Magdadraft pa lang po, ma'am. Kasi, i-integrate na po lang adoption laws sana.
Let me first acknowledge the presence of Senator Villar.
Good afternoon.
Sige, ano yung sinasabi mo?
Yes, ma'am. Magdadraft po lang ng bill na para maging administrative proceedings po lahat ng adoption, ay maging administrative process, adoption proceedings, including all cases po ng adoption, either simulated birth certificate or yung regular po siya. Pero wala pa po sa ngayon.
San galing yung ano na yon, yung change in direction na gusto nyong, I'm just curious.
Opo. Based
from
po
the
kasi
feedback
dahil,
na sobrang tagal
yes,
sa
po,
judicial.
Yun po, yun ma'am, sa sobrang tagal po na based on experience at mga nangyayari, tapos result po ng mga TWG, mga discussions po with mga reviews ng mga existing laws. So nakita po na doon po medyo nagtatagal talaga. Kasi ang ngayon po, ang administrative proceedings pa lang po yung certification declaring the child as legally available for adoption. So, nasa DSW na po siya na dati pong judicial process. Pero ang kaagip, yun po nga siya ma'am.
So ang gusto niyo mangyari after certifying that the child is legally available for adoption, yun na rin dapat yun. Yun na rin yung adoption process na.
Didiretso po siya sa adoption process na hindi na mag-judiciary. So after ma-declare siya legally available for adoption, kung regular adoption po siya, so may ma-match yung bata prospective adoptive parents sa so suitable sa needs niya. So after po siya ma-issue ng pre-adoption placement authority and adoption consent, affidavit of consent to adoption, hindi na po siya mapupunta sa court kasi naman po ganun. So, yun po yung hindi na namin na-handle kasi sa court na po yun. So, dun po yung medyo matagal. Na-understandable naman po. So, kung sa DSWD na po siya, mas mapapaiksi na po yung process. Pero ang sinasabi nga po namin, lahat na po sa ng adoption cases na hindi lang dun sa mga nag-simulate ng birth certificate.
I understand the process kasi I'm adopting my...
Ah, yes, ma'am. Opo.
Sobrang
matagal
ng process. So, I understand your concern. Paano kaya natin mapapabilis yun? Kasi kung sasabihin natin na aantayin natin ito para yon, dapat gawin na natin yon. So, siguro I will ask my staff and the secretariat to sit down with you because pwede naman natin gawin agad yon. Dahil naiintindihan ko naman yung process eh.
Yes po.
Okay. Anyway, let's just put on record everybody else's concern and comments on this. DOJ, there. Attorney Mendoza, your thoughts.
Madam Chair, good afternoon. We had reservations as far as decriminalizing simulation of birth certificates.
Okay.
The fact that this is tampering with a public document, we are not supporting as far as decriminalizing is concerned. With regards to the, we support the intention of the bill because it is to the interest of the child, but who would say that it is to the interest of the child if initially there was tampering of the birth certificate. It would appear that in the birth certificate, the biological parent would appear that the adopting parent would appear as the biological parent. So in these cases, I am not really familiar with how it is, no, but I have read and I have seen on television that parents, biological parents who would resort to this are paid a certain amount of money so that they could agree to this simulation. So simulation would refer to people who are in the hospital concerned with the registry, the biological parent and the adoptive parent. So we have reservations as far as decriminalizing is concerned. But as to the process, we defer to the DSWD for the adoption process. Thank you.
You're concerned, that's your job to be concerned about it. But not all would do it for money. There are really those who, I know of so many, I did not do it myself, but by the time I met my son, he was 9 months, and I'm a public figure. I cannot pretend not to be pregnant when everybody sees me. Not that I would resort to it. But there are many who do it out of, it's like, I liken it to live-in. So many of our poor fellow Filipinos end up not getting married because of the additional expense of getting married. So they also say, I've also talked to a lot of people who've done that. It's either may aamponin sila na never nila pinrosis yung papers, never. And then, or they'll resort to simulated birth so that daw maging kapareho din yung rights ng bata. And then there are those, like you have mentioned, that have done it for maliciously or for gain. So you do have a valid concern. But the question remains then, how do we recognize the plight of many who are really scared of the prohibitive cost and time it takes to adopt? I'm not aware of any. And I actually, DSWD, please confirm or educate us. Meron familiar ba kayo sa mga families who are living in the, you know, below poverty or poverty level who will actually go through the process of adoption? Have you? Oo. Ayun nga eh. It's either walang papeles yung kawawang batang yon or sinimulate na lang nila yung birth. Yun nga eh. So that's the reality that we are faced with. How do we address that? And on another matter, we also have concerns on many children, whether they are neglected, not even abandoned, but born in poverty situation. Ni hindi nga nire-register ang birth, no? Nandito ba ang ano, ang statistics? There you are, PSA. Ma'am, mag-comment na rin kayo. Can you give us data on how many unregistered births there are? Would you know? Any idea?
Good afternoon po, Madam Chair. Good afternoon sa lahat. Ma'am, based po doon sa ating 2010 census of population, 93.5 births were already registered. So 93.5, about 6.5 are not yet registered.
Oh, yun nga. Can you imagine? This was a campaign that I got involved with. It's an international campaign. When I was a newly elected senator, 2004 pa yun, to really recognize the need to register. Can you imagine going through life, every single one of us sitting here without a birth certificate? How do you apply for a job? How do you, because 10% of our population end up going abroad, how do you apply for a passport? Technically, how do you even go to school? Diba? So then you're faced with that situation. Out of the 6.5 though, ma'am, do we know if those 6.5 were children living with their biological parents or not? I don't think that's probably too much info, no? But in any case, you can assume that a certain percent of them did not grow up with their biological parents, diba? So paano yun? These are problems that we need to put our heads together and solve. We can't say na basta hindi lang. Do you have any thoughts?
Probably,
yes, Attorney Mendoza.
we could speed up the process of the adoption and to lower the cost. But we cannot, we are as if condoning simulation. We are criminalizing the act, not the intention. But we cannot condone somebody who simulated a birth certificate. Then anybody can do so, can circumvent this law and put it as, I mean, it, for the intention of the, for the interest of the child. So there are specific circumstances, yes, we recognize that, but we cannot condone that as far as the department is concerned. Thank you.
But is, do you open the floodgates to traffickers? Diba? I mean, ako, I really recognize, ha? Kasi nga, I've been through the adoption process, eh. So, hindi, may, ako pa nga, wala pa akong horror stories compared to the others. I've had a matagal, but not delayed, not in any way intentional. Talagang ganun ang process. Pero I don't think many, especially those who are poor, can undergo it. So I don't know the, I don't know how we can resolve this. Maybe I will call for a TWG on this bill, and everybody who has a say here can be present. Yes, Attorney Fernandez. Sorry, I cannot see, so I do not know where you are from.
Thank you, Madam DFA Chair, ba? From DFA po.
DFA, okay.
Madam Chair, just 2 points. One, we noticed that there's a process of adoption involved, and we would like to share with you that these cases sometimes extend to couples who are abroad. They simulate the birth for a child to be brought with them abroad in hope of giving that child a better future. If the representation could...
Nurse or Filipinos?
Filipinos, Madam Chair.
Who are residents abroad
who
already?
Are going abroad, and they get a relative of theirs born from a niece, a nephew, or a cousin, and they simulate the birth and they bring this child abroad. We notice that there's a provision on a report to be conducted by DSWD, and it's the social welfare officer from the city or municipality. In case that the child is brought abroad, we're hoping that the bill could also answer who takes care of the case study of the child when the child is abroad. And second point, Madam Chair, we are very firm before the international community in advocating an anti-trafficking in person campaign. And if the Chair may remember, simulation of birth is one of those listed as trafficking. So may wish to consider the impact this would have on our prestige in countering trafficking before the international community. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you for that, Attorney Fernandez. The prestige for me is secondary to the actual the actual implications of our act. No, I mean, for me, if I can justify the reasons for a certain decision, that I can explain that in a way that will tell the community that we have to do it a certain way. But more important, as you mentioned, trafficking is a mode. And if it will, in fact, aid in trafficking, we cannot be in any way, we don't want to open the Pandora's box on that matter. So I'm just curious, did any of you attend the hearings in the lower house? Did you have similar discussions? Anyone here? Okay, sige. I'll just ask for the records also of the House, and then let's move this to TWG. I mean, significant concerns have been raised, so we can only proceed by digging a little bit deeper and trying to find... Yes, Ms. Makabagdal.
If we can also engage in the TWG meetings, the members of child caring associations of the
sure,
Philippines.
Of course.
Because they are more experienced in handling children,
of, okay.
Yes, who, and they have direct experience in engaging the birth parents, so they would probably, most probably, share experiential learning.
So, siguro sa ano rin, sa civil registrar's office, did we invite them? We did invite. But they're not here. O, sulatan nyo sila ng love letter na sa susunod. Mag-attend naman sila, please. Okay? Okay, and anyone else who you feel we should invite to the TWG, please let us know. Okay? So, let's proceed.
Let me go first to this bill on... I'll go to this next one, yeah. I'll go to the bill amending Article 21 of the Family Code, House Bill Number 4828, an act providing for additional requirements for a male foreigner desiring to marry a Filipina, amending for the purpose Article 21 of EO 209, otherwise known as the Family Code. DSWD, DOJ, DFA, and PCW to comment on this. So basically, the law is quite simple. It says that when the male contracting party is a foreigner, in addition to the certificate of legal capacity, a certificate of good moral character, and a certificate of gainful trade, business, employment, or other lawful source of income issued by his diplomatic or consular official must be submitted before a marriage license can be obtained. In other words, dati legal capacity lang, ibig sabihin, siya ay single. Ngayon, sabi natin, in addition to that, kailangan good moral character at hindi siya magiging palamunin ng Pilipina. Yun yun. Interestingly, it doesn't apply the other way around. So this we don't have a counterpart Senate bill. We are hearing this because this was forwarded already to us by the House. So comments. May I start with the SWD?
Madam Chair, based on our position paper, the department wished to express its reservation on the bill. We believe that additional requirements for male citizens or subjects of a foreign country desiring to marry a Filipina propagate old gender stereotype and thus highly discriminatory and contrary to the Equal Protection Clause of the Constitution. Instead, we strongly recommend strengthening pre-marriage counseling procedures, capacitating service providers posted at the DFA and Commission on Filipino Overseas to enable them to discern possible fraudulence behind the foreign applications.
Sorry, what was your last line? I just missed it. I was being briefed on something.
We wish to express our reservations on the bill because this propagates all gender stereotypes and is highly discriminatory and contrary to the Equal Protection Clause of the Constitution.
So, but that's why my question. Well, I was whispering to Senator Villar. I said it. Then I whispered to her. Doesn't work the other way around. So would it address your stereotype if we also said that any female, when the male or female contracting party is a foreigner, it does. Okay, it addresses the stereotype that you're not just discriminating against the male being the breadwinner in that manner, but it's still then the remaining question is, does the state get involved in deciding who to marry and what the qualifications of that person is? I mean, if that person was taking up a PhD but was a bum, masama ba yon? Kasi if I base it on this, gainfully employed, gainful trade, business, employment, or other lawful source of income. O, paano nga kung PhD, ano siya, talagang ano, gutom na PhD student. Technically, you can't marry that person. We will now say that you can't marry that person.
And if we can inquire, what is the intention of the bill?
So well, that we can't able inquire to because I'm just hearing it. But yes, I agree with you. I'm guessing, again, it's not my job to defend this. I'm hearing it because it's in my committee. We can ask the House. This is a bill passed by the House. I'm guessing that is to protect the women supposedly from those who foreigners who would want to take advantage of them. I'm guessing that that's what it is. But we also have, I will call on her in a few minutes, a representative from Visayan Forum who deals with these kind of bills, and I'm sure they have something to add to this. But let me just go through my list. DSWD, Attorney Castro.
Madam Chair, we have supported this bill at the House of Representatives.
Okay.
However, with the inclusion of Section 2 that the Department of Justice shall promulgate the rules and regulations, we do not know the intention why the DOJ will be the lead agency on this bill.
Okay, and do you recall the basis for your support? I mean, is it basically to, let's answer the question, to protect women? What's the reason?
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, again. Yes, it is to protect Filipino women from marrying foreigners whose real motive for marriage is to take advantage and exploit these women by making them work for them or sending them to prostitution or other degrading and dehumanizing occupations. As far as I recall, I attended the technical working group as well in the House. Yes, it's all right. As far as I recall, we attended the technical working group, and DSWD was there also, represented, and they had the same position, not being applicable to a female foreigner. Yes, they gave the same position.
I just want to make a comment, Chairman, that that bill will not prevent that. By requiring them to work here, will prevent their trafficking of our women to other places. I don't think that's the way to prevent it. Parang the reason is not valid for that kind of practice na, to pass this bill. How will this bill prevent those trafficking practices? I want to know.
This is an existing law already under the Family Code, Article 21. So they were just adding requirements to the existing law. A certificate of legal capacity to contract marriage is the only requirement in the existing law.
Requiring them under to work. Family Code.
Well, just to put on record, no, I'm reading the statement of Congresswoman Gwen Garcia, former governor. She pointed out that public knowledge that some of foreigners coming to the Philippines in order to marry Filipino women are vagabonds or social and moral derelicts in their own country, and whose real motive for marriage is only to take advantage and exploit our women by making them work, and worse, by sending them to prostitution and other degrading and dehumanizing occupations. So as I pointed out earlier, I was certain that this was the intention, but Senator Villar does have a...
I think the reason is they want to make sure that the men marrying our women are working
responsible,
men, responsible. I think that's the reason for this kind of bill, maybe. But I think they should put more requirements if that's what they want. In other countries, what they do is you have to bring a certain amount of money. Diba?
To invest or to marry?
Oh, invest. That kind of requirement to make sure that they are not good for nothing people there who's coming here. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's the way they do it. Parang you have to invest a certain amount of money. Maybe because what do they want? Employment? They be employed here?
Certificate of appears to me at the
origin
of work, kasi a certificate of gainful trade, business, employment, lawful source of income issued by his diplomatic or consular office.
Okay.
So from the source,
from the source.
Country, yes.
I guess that would be okay, because they will. You have to prove that you have the capacity. I think it's proving that you have the capacity to contract marriage. Just like if you want an investor's visa, you have to raise a certain amount of money. Maybe that can be a requirement, a capacity to take care of the Filipina in the marriage relation, in the marriage, to prevent those people who are here just to take advantage of them. Maybe that's the reason. So we can attract better foreigners.
Jay, let me hear from DFA.
Thank you, Madam Chair. 3 points, Madam Chair. First, we appreciate the intention of the bill is to protect our Filipino women, which we fully support. Second, Madam Chair, we wish to note that there may be some procedural burden in terms of bona fide marriages. We only have 84 foreign service posts. If a national will be coming from a country where we don't have an embassy, then that person would need either to travel to the nearest Philippine Foreign Service post or find some other Philippine Foreign Service to authenticate the certificate issued by his or her foreign ministry. The third, Madam Chair, as we have only been reviewing the bill recently, we'd wish to be afforded some time to see its effect on other international human rights legal instruments to which we are a party to see if it has impact on them. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Yeah. You put an added burden in as much as I'm also all for the protection of women. Like I mentioned a case where, what if it's a student, it's a PhD. I mean, I wouldn't mind if my daughter would marry somebody with a PhD. you know, there are circumstances that we should look into that may not fall into the strict requirements that we are, or the, even our intention. So that's also where I'm looking at. We'd like you to look at it, Attorney Fernandez.
Maybe if the requirement, if you're a trafficker, then maybe you have a record of crime committed in another place, di ba?
For those who are part of the syndicate, yeah. Pero for those, there are those who would just be used. It's possible that they don't have a record. Anyway, we have somebody from Visayan Forum. We'll call on her, yeah, in a minute to share their experiences on this. Let me just call on PCW.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. The Philippine Commission on Women also supports the intention of, of protecting women. However, we also express our reservation on the bill, as similar to what we have done during the committee meeting at the House of Representatives. First, as mentioned already by DSWD, because this bill will only be affecting women, and we feel that it runs contrary to the provision of the Magna Carta, which grants equal rights to women and men to enter into marriage. So that's the first point. And then second is on the additional requirements, similar to what DFA has already mentioned on the requirements that would be needed if the embassy would also be able to, for instance, because it mentioned here, there is a one for a certificate of good moral character. If there is an agency in this country, so would be able to provide this. Also, as you have mentioned, even if they are able to present a certificate of gainful trade, it does not, if the intention is to protect women from traffickers or whatever, or from being victimized by foreigners, it would not be a guarantee that because the person is gainfully employed or has gainful trade, that he would be a good husband to the Filipina. And then third, we see that there are many measures in place to address the concerns of the good House Representative Garcia, because we already have, and will be discussed, as will be discussed later, the amendment to the anti-mail order bride. So we already have that law, and also the Anti-Trafficking Act. So we think that these measures would already address the concerns that this bill is trying to address. at the same time, we are thinking that while it would protect women, we are also thinking about the similarity of this measure with the night work prohibition, where the intention is good, but then the implication on the women when it was included in the labor code. So that's what we're thinking about. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Nowadays, any time that you distinguish between men and women, we know enough to look into the implications of that. We have learned from experience that although women and men are very different, you have to be careful with the differentiations that we make, because they could create unintentional discrimination. And that's also a concern that I have. Then again, women are very exposed to these kind of things, but it also brings to mind that a lot of young boys are also exploited. Huh? You could have 18-year-old boys who are exploited nowadays with gay marriages abroad and, again, trafficking. So let's hear from Cecil Urbanda of Visayan Forum.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you for inviting us. Definitely, we appreciate all effort really to protect our women and children, because, like, for example, in Visayan Forum, we have cases of foreigners who come to the Philippines and marry young girls and women and for marriage, you know. But at the end, a lot of these girls also end up in trafficking situations or even in a very also abusive situation. Narinig naman natin po sa mga balita na kahit yung foreigner na nandito po, marami din po yung mga na-rescue na natin, marami din po tayo na mga nakuhuli na nagpakasal sa mga babae natin, pero yung ginagawa po nila, ginagamit nila ito sa cybersex at saka sa pornography para pagkikitaan at abusuhin. I think this is where the good congressman is coming from, because in Cebu, there's actually registered a lot of cases similar to this. Yeah, but having said that, I agree that we need really to articulate more and to examine more the proposed bill in line with the international human rights standard that actually our government is party with. For us in the Visayan Forum, I think I would like also to support the recommendation of good Senator Villar to examine the history of a foreigner, especially their criminal activities, because a lot of these people who married are women has actually previous record already in their own country. Yeah, iba po sa kanila mga sex offender na po. No? Meron na po silang mga records. At saka sa tingin namin, kung ano man, kahit anong pakahirap para sa government, it's our responsibility really to examine that beyond maybe economic capacity or whatsoever, because I think most and foremost our responsibility is to make sure that the women and children, including men and boys, are actually protected by law. So, yun lang po. Second po, yung patuloy na design forum. You're right, madam.
Wait, let me just take that point further. So, what would your recommendation be that, you know, similar to in our existing family code, if a son or daughter wants to get married at the age of between 18 to 21, they need parental consent. Parang ganon, we'll ask, if it's a foreigner, we'll ask for a waiting period for who though to make a study. Because I agree, I'd love for any, you know, ke mayaman ka, ke mahirap ka, educated ka o hindi, pwede ka talagang maloko just by the sheer distance, the background of that person, di ba? So, who would provide that?
Well, I think the country of origin has existing, you know, database or records.
Kaya nga, so parang ganito rin will make it the burden of the foreigner to produce.
Yeah, ma'am, we cannot just close.
NBI clearance.
Yes, yeah, parang ganon. Yeah. We cannot just close our eyes to the cases that we have now, you know.
So on that note, we're saying na pag foreigner ka, magbigay ka ng NBI clearance. Pagka Pinoy ka, hindi.
then I'll throw the question back at you. Pero ang question ko is, are there more foreign traffickers than Filipinos?
And even if
we're not talking about trafficking, manluloko na Filipino din?
So women, boys, and girls. Kahit babae, kahit lalaki, may NBI clearance.
Kaya nga, also, pero yun nga, basta foreigner lang. So paano yung kung manluloko Filipino?
Well, I think we can do both, ma'am. So I don't know, but I think for us coming here is that really
assumption is kasi kung Pilipino ka through our kamag-anak network, you can do a fair amount of investigation to warn your child, your pamangkin. Actually, I was going to say hindi rin kasi 100 million na tayo eh, wala naman tayong family planning. So without family planning, hindi na natin kayang with too many we don't have the resources for that. So yun lang ang ano ko, like I love the intention, I really do. I just don't know how, when do we differentiate and when do we say di na natin kayang proteksyonan yan. Go ahead, I give the floor
back to you.
I think
that's why I'm saying, ma'am, that we need really to study this, because so I think there are other models, like for example the UK government. Mm-hmm. You know, they have a very strong Australian government, have a strong system actually. No, and they have a strong database of their sex offenders. So I think we have something that we can start off. But for example, with the questions kung kailan din tong Pinoy, I think I would say that generally we need really to scrutinize and make a practical recommendation on this bill. I don't have any direct answer to your question, but I'll say that based on what's happening now, you know, there are ways that we can really protect and look on what other countries' existing policies and protections in place. Thank you.
The objective is, I think the objective is not so much to ensure na yung mapapangasawa is mayaman, no? Hindi sa ganun eh. It's more of to have a certain amount of security such that Filipinos, whether women or men, do not end up marrying somebody with involvement in sexual offenses. More of that, that's one. And then the other is, I'm not sure, because again, this is not my bill. I don't know if it's just sexual offenses or possible abusive situations. Parang yun yung dalawa. Yun yung dalawang objective, which are laudable for sure. It's just nga, what falls within the right of the state to intervene in these personal decisions, and if we could also find best practices. Attorney Fernandez, baka you could also assist with best practices abroad. You could check with our embassies abroad what have they seen. Attorney Mendoza.
Just to add, no? Kasi I believe yung certificates would be the basis, kahit pa paano, basis ng Filipina to check yung background, because wala siyang access because of the distance. She has no access to records abroad. Unlike dito, if there is doubt, she can always check yung records ng Filipino. Kaya siguro, sir, ma'am, ang intention is yung certificates, we should rely dun sa certificates na may record ba siya, kung sexual offender. Yun, ma'am, yung distance kasi, yung access to records to verify yung background ng tao.
I say something. I think in this case, the government should do this kasi alam mo yung mga gusto mag-asawa. From wala is mahina ulo, nasisira ulo. So I think we should interfere in this case, especially these women marrying yung mga foreigner na hindi naman nila kilala, ganon. Akala nila kasi yung life with this foreigner is all roses, ba? Even the OFWs who are going to be domestic helper abroad, Actually, they get paid the same here, eh, but they go abroad because they think it's you'll be a tourist there and enjoy life. The, hindi nila alam ikukulong sila sa bahay sa Middle East na hindi man sila makakalabas. So I think in this case, the government should require something because, di ba, love is blind and lovers cannot see. We should take care of our women, especially most of them are uneducated, di ba, and poor. So they try to build, parang dream ba, dream come true. So maybe the government should really interfere in this kind of things para ipakita lang sa kanila kung may mga records, police records, or sabi nga records of violence para mag-double, magdalawang isip naman sila whether they're going to get married or not. Kasi as I see people, when they like to get married, parang blinded sila, di ba? So maybe it's good if we will do some little checking for them. Hindi nila gagawin yun eh. Kaya kawawa naman.
Thank you, Senator Villar. Can I call on Judge Arcega of San Beda College? She's a family law professor in San Beda College.
Good afternoon, Senators Caetano and Villar. When I look into the bill, I think this bill may invite gender sensitivity issues. Men are also vulnerable, like women. So, if we will require this to the foreigners, we might as well require this to our local, to our locals. Since, di ba, yun ang problema lagi, pera, pag nag-aaway, pag nagkakagalit. So, para maiwasan na rin yung mga break-up of marriages. Kung i-require natin, maybe we can we not ask the, kung hindi i-wired na gano'n na legal capacity plus good moral plus business something, can you not include that in the legal capacity? Just include that in the legal capacity.
Legal capacity is defined as the not having any
precise
any barriers to marriage, including the ability to perform your responsibilities.
Parang ganito, kung isasama na lang siya para hindi mag-invite ng mga gender sensitivity issues or whatever issues. Kasi parang bakit sa foreigner meron, bakit sa local wala? Hindi natin pinoprotektahan yung ating mga tao from the locals also, sa foreigners lang. Di ba when people decide to get married, at least 18 and above na sila. They can check on their own. Parang may warning na sila. Alam na nila dapat yung kanilang ginagawa. Parang surplusage, tingin ko lang po, as a practitioner and as a professor. Pero wala nang problema if this can kung sana ako mapoprotektahan nito yung women talaga, kung this will be the gauge na hindi matatraffic ang women, why not?
Okay, thank you. Let's proceed. Commission of Filipino Overseas. Saan kayo? Okay, Attorney De La Cruz or no, Mr. Toloso? Sino sa inyo?
Bitasa po.
Ah, sino ba? Ay, sorry. Ito yung dala ko sa PSA ka pala. Saan ka ba? PSA?
Sa PSA po, ma'am.
You want to say something also?
Yes.
Oh, sige, unahin ko lang. Sige. Kahit sino sa inyo?
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Your Honor. I have some apprehensions with this bill, Your Honor, please, because some countries like the United States of America and Canada do not issue this certificate of legal capacity to contract marriage.
Mm.
Yes, ma'am. Now we are again adding another requirement for
so
this.
So if
filing.
They don't issue, paano?
USA issues the affidavit, madam.
What does it say in the affidavit?
But this affidavit will be executed by the citizen of America, stating therein that he has the legal capacity to contract marriage.
Okay.
And Canada requires the statutory declaration of the Canadian, stating therein that he has the capacity to contract marriage also.
Yung sa Canadian, sino ang nag-issue sila, the contracting party?
That will be executed by the person who wants to marry in the Philippines.
Oh, the contracting party nga.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So we've started to accept. We accept that.
No, ma'am.
We don't.
Yes, because the law specifically states.
So paano they cannot marry?
The LCR does not issue the marriage license, ma'am.
That's interesting because that has not been brought to my attention. I have not attempted to marry a foreigner.
That's why I have no personal knowledge.
Pero hindi ko alam yun kasi pag ganon, we should review the law. Kasi, so technically, we do not encourage them to get married. Kasi they'll incapable sila to produce that kind of certificate kasi hindi nag-i-issue yung bansang yun.
Yes,
diba?
Madam. In fact, madam, just recently, ma'am, we received a letter from Robert J. Joaquin, Chief of the American Citizen Services and Consul of the United States of America, dated June 23, 2015, stating therein that they do not issue the legal capacity or any comparable certificate to the American citizens because they do not have national marriage registry, madam.
Hi, that's very interesting. Okay. But you could make an exemption naman, di ba, in countries that cannot provide, then at least you let this person testify for himself or tell him to get from his state. Pwede naman yun from his state. Oh, anyway, this is going to be a different subject matter. Can we just invite you to give us your suggestions in general?
Yes, ma'am.
On foreign marriages.
Yes, ma'am.
Lumawak na. But anyway, on this particular, do you have anything else to add?
No, ma'am.
So your point is, ito pang existing, may mga hindi na tayo makakomply,
yes,
magdadagdag pa tayo.
Yes, I think there is a need to have consultation with the different embassies, ma'am.
Oo nga eh. Yeah, I don't know nga. Kasi medyo mahirap yun yung siguro yung income, pwede mong makita sa doc, if they have a document similar to their income tax, they could produce that. Pero yung any gainful employment, paano kung hindi pa filing for that year, di ba? Maraming ang mga little nuances. Sige, Mr. Vitasa.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Sige, sandali ha. Sorry ha, dalawang beses na kita pero para lang for continuity, yes.
May question ako, di ba? Marriage license is secured from the place where any one of the contracting parties is residing.
Yes, ma'am.
Right?
Yes, ma'am.
So I have to check. Alam ko, mayroon mga American citizen and Canadian citizen who got married.
Yes, ma'am.
So they should have sila ng marriage license.
Yes, ma'am.
So maybe the local civil registrars accept that kind of affidavit, not the certificate of legal capacity. Because I know of some American citizens and Canadian citizens who got married in the Philippines.
Yes.
So, yun yung yun, siguro tinatanggap nung local civil registrar na ito na yun. So, hindi pala sila dapat kinakasal dito?
ano yun? Voidable?
Ha?
Voidable marriage ba yun? Voidable kaya yun?
If they were... Hindi, it's valid. It's valid. However, the issuing authority can be administratively criminally liable. But it's valid because a marriage license has been issued to
also
them.
Acquired.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Mr. Vitasa,
in connection with the point of our colleague from Attorney De La Cruz, actually, ma'am, the real problem nanggagaling po dito sa Article 18 ng Family Code. If we'll go into the Article 18 of the Family Code, yung local civil registrar po kasi wala siyang magagawa, may impediment magkihiwala. He or she has to issue the marriage license. And yun po ang nagiging ugat ng problema na kahit may impediment na, nagkakaroon sila ng marriage license. And after na meron silang marriage license, ikinakasal na po sila. And we'd like to point out at this point in time na kung pwede ho sana, if you could look into this provision, kung pwede, or siguro it's about time na ito ay i-amend, or kung hindi man ay ayusin, kasi nga po, despite the impediment na present, the local civil registrar has just to note na merong impediment. But still, she would issue the marriage license. And then, I-continue ko na po kasi sa amin, sa Commission on Filipinos Overseas, we're directly dealing with the Filipinos marrying foreign nationals. So dito na ho kasi nagkakaroon ng problema. Pag nakita ho namin sa mga dokumento, sa mga kung ano-ano pong sinasubmit nila, na may diferensya ho yung kanilang pagkakakasal, wala na ho kaming nagagawa kasi kasal na ho sila. And then, the worst thing, halimbawa po kasi sa amin, ang isang Filipina, nag-asawa ng foreign national, he has to get that counseling certificate. So, there are times na we really put on hold the issuance of the certificate because of, halimbawa, maaaring siya yung victim ng domestic violence or whatever, or possible victim siya ng trafficking, hinuhold po namin yung kanilang certificate. Eh, pero kung halimbawa po kasal na sila, minsan ina-abandon na po sila ng mga foreign husbands nila or foreign national na mga asawa.
You were talking about situations where hinold nyo ang... Ano yung hinold nyo?
Guidance and Counseling Certificate po.
Because...
Halimbawa po nga kasi siya ay maaaring victim ng mail order bride or trafficking.
Ah, pag based on the circumstances, nakikita nyo na parang ganun ang
yes, ma'am.
Profile.
Apa. So parang sinasubject po siya sa further counseling and then minsan po yung mga talagang victim or product ng mail order scheme or mail order bride scheme, ina-abandon na po ng mga asawa nilang foreign national dahil nakikita nila na baka habulin po sila ng ating gobyerno. And that particular instance, parang naiiwan na po sa RAC Filipina na married po ang status niya. Tapos abandoned na po siya ng kanilang mga foreign husbands.
Is it an option? But I'll call a TWG for sure, ha? Just leaving some ideas to ponder on. Coming from that experience, kasi malaking bagay talaga yung counseling, eh. To me nga, that should really be the main thing, no? Information, counseling, awareness. One thing that came to my mind is that because if there is a human right violation in imposing these requirements, because you're impinging on the freedom to choose your spouse, di ba? Sinasabi natin na kailangan ganito siya, ganito, ganito. If we were to say that what you are imposing is counseling to enable you to find out these things for yourself to the extent possible, and if you cannot obtain it, then like you said, natutuloy din naman ang kasal nila because the marriage license is issued. But then we make the marriage voidable para naman it becomes easier for the victim to leave that situation. Because there are just so many layers of our existing structures that make it so difficult for both a woman or a man who's abused to get out of that situation. So I'm not requiring any answers. It's just a thought that I'm putting out there. Now, if we create these layers of protection para mas effective in the long run. But all of your inputs were extremely helpful. Let's call a separate TWG for this, okay? Thank you. So let's continue on to the related topic, which is anti-mail order bride. I guess I should have just heard them together. Yun na muna. Tuloy na natin sa anti-mail order because was it you, Cecil, was saying na connected to dito sa isang pending bill? You were the one, right? Yeah. So, why don't I start with you, no? Again, this is a House bill that has already been elevated to the Senate. It's an act providing stronger measures against unlawful practices, business and schemes of matching and offering Filipinos to foreign nationals for purpose of marriage or common law partnerships. Would you like to start?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think this bill is really on the recognition that there's also an increasing cases of men or boys actually trapped in this situation. Lubisayan Forum po support this this bill, but I think same with the other bill, there is a lot of areas that we need to examine, especially that I think the new phenomena of gay marriage abroad is is becoming a new trend and new wave. And sa experience po namin po sa Visayan Forum, hindi lang po babae yung at mga kabataang babae po na biktima, kundi there's also an increasing cases of boys and men actually abused by, you know, by foreigners, used by the foreigners, not only physically but also through internet at saka other forms po. So I think it's a high time for us really to recognize that these things are happening, but at this point, again, we would like to see and look on the implication of this to other existing law and the constitutionality of this, you know, of this bill.
Call on PCW.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. The PCW highly supports the proposed measure passed by the House of Representatives. In fact, the PCW is a member of the TWG, or the Technical Working Group meeting called by the House of Representatives to consolidate the two bills pending with the House before. And we also submitted the position and comments on this consolidated bill, and the comments are already integrated in the past version of the House of Representatives. Yes, ma'am.
It's now gender neutral.
Yes. And revising the title to make the bill gender neutral and considering matchmaking not only as a guise for intermarriages but also for common law partnerships, and then strengthening the protection and support services for victims, and also the confiscation and forfeiture of proceeds and instruments.
Okay, my suggestion is, can you review this? Because again, I'll have to call a TWG on this, no? But can you review, and I'll also ask judge to comment, anybody else who wants to comment, can we make this kind of marriages voidable? Because it can still happen, you prohibited it, pero pag hindi mo nahuli yan, mangyayari pa rin yan. So my one suggestion to complete the layer of protection is to also make it voidable, such that if hindi maagapan, natuloy ang kasal, the victim has a way out, both in our country and, well, elsewhere, bahala na siya. But at least, ang masakit sa lahat na to, in our own country, they have no protection. Diba? That's so sad, kasi kinasal ka eh. Sorry, bawal pala yun, hindi nahuli, pero kasal ka na. That's really sad. So that's what I'd like to explore in the TWG, paki-take note, no? But offhand, I know that this is an issue that this kasi is one issue. This is one way of capturing the concerns raised in the other issue, in the other bill, which is, you know, any Filipino can end up in a situation like that. But this one particularly captures when there's like this advertisement na talagang mail order bride yung dating. What the other one is envisioning is hindi naman binroadcast, hindi naman inadvertise, pero ma-abuse din siya in either a schematic way or not. Okay, I think that's, unless somebody has anything to add here, I'll move along on this one. Yes, Mr. Vitasa.
Yes, ma'am, thank you. We have gone through the House Bill 5572. Since if you will be calling for the TWG, we would like to be invited for that particular matter, so that we can put everything out, yung mga gusto namin or pwede namin maidagdag para nang, kasi po, as you may know, kami po yung may direktang mga opisina na nakikipag-deal sa mga ganitong klase ngayon. Thank you, ma'am.
Meanwhile, you can feel free to put together your position paper so that, in fact, it really just depends on the schedule of my staff, but we can have a TWG within a week, within 2 weeks. But if you can gather your thoughts and if you have people to discuss this with, put together your concerns already, and you can either submit it or just have it ready. So when we call the TWG, we're ready to move forward. Kasi we only have a few months to work on this. So if we want to try to pass something, I need to put it on the floor in about a month's time. Okay, so let's move forward. Let me just move things.
Madam Chair, we just have one position.
Sure.
although you will be convening a TWG meeting, but we would like to put on record that it says that the SWD shall mainly be responsible for the implementation of preventive, protective, and rehabilitative programs of services. We are proposing that the prevention should be deleted because in terms of protection of victims, yes, it is us, but in terms of preventing the act to happen, it is not only the SWD's responsibility. So we would like that to be in record and be considered in the next meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's move to Judge, yes.
Will the TWG be dedicated to the amendment of or revision of some family code provisions?
Well, for now, on the bills that we've heard, do you have something else related or unrelated?
Yeah, it's actually related because there will be an upcoming summit of family courts. So dun ho makikita mako-consolidate ho namin lahat ng problematic areas, especially Article 26, second paragraph, yung foreigner divorce, recognition of foreign judgment or foreign divorce.
Okay.
So in September, second week of September.
Okay.
So maybe is that too late?
I will wait for that input, but maybe we can still probably have something so we move forward and then we'll get the additional input. It just might be more practical. But if the schedule works out that we have our first after that one, because it's a waste of valuable information if we don't consider it. So for sure we will. It's just a question of maybe we should have one round first and then have that as our second round when you have.
We will submit a position paper.
Yeah. Okay,
thank you.
So let's go now to the next bill, which is So our next bill is Article 75 of the Family Code, and this one is changing our property regime from absolute community to conjugal partnership of gains. So we now have, under our family code, it's the absolute community, and the bill is now reverting to conjugal property, which was the default regime under the civil code before we had our family code. So comments, let's start with PCW.
Unfortunately, Madam Chair, we are still studying the bill and we have not come up with a position on the
okay, you didn't have one before, a position on this before.
It's no, Madam Chair.
Those issues. Okay, sige. Can you please?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I'll go to Judge Arcedi.
100% agree.
Can you elaborate for the sake of everybody here who has not had experience?
So, 100% agree. Kasi mahirap yung mahirap yung absolute community. Lahat ng properties ninyo, dala-dala nyo dito sa marriage. Unlike conjugal partnership, only those income, interest of your exclusive properties will be put into a common fund. So, tapos lahat lang ng earnings. So, yung exclusive yung kung ano man yung ninanan nyo, kung ano man yung nabili nyo prior to the marriage. So, ngayon, para maiwasan nga, as the explanation said, for the freeloaders, yun lang gusto nila. So, baka ma-avoid natin yung ibang problems in the future. So, mahirap naman pagka complete separation will be the default property regime. So, it's better na conjugal partnership of gain. also the interest of those who put in their separate properties.
Judge, for sure, I'm inclined to support this measure. No, I mean, actually, it's a position I've had even before. But for me to defend it on the floor, I will be asked about the advantages and disadvantages, most of which you've summarized, actually, and also what is the regime. Because I remember when I was a student, what was often, what was actually dumped on us was the fact that mas hiyang sa customs ng Filipinos, parang we're more inclined, we are naturally more inclined towards a absolute property regime. I wasn't married then, so I couldn't really say. But from a lot of now having more than 20 years after my student days, I can say that I really disagree that it has become more complicated to move out of an absolute. And even if you remain married, it becomes so complicated because so much of the exclusive properties are not officially disclosed, and since, you know, your parents are still alive, they're still surviving, it becomes so complicated when the other spouse now suddenly has a grasp or as a claim, no, to that. So that's my position. But Judge, baka you can lay it out in a more succinct way, or even submit it to us in writing. I mean, say whatever you want now, then I'll ask you to submit it in writing so that we can really use it when we defend it.
Okay, I will submit my position paper.
Great.
Isang problem pa pala niyan, yung absolute community of property. Yung parents, just to avoid giving the children who are about to get married the property, minsan pinapangalan sa ibang tao. So, minsan ganun eh. Hindi clear kasi. So yung ibang tao sometimes nag-i-interest. So ayun, dumadami yung kaso.
Lumaki pa yung problema. That's so interesting, no?
It's an actual experience.
Wow, okay. Yes, I understand. Oh, because kung ikakasal yung anak mo sa hindi mo masyado gusto, ang bigat sa loob mo na yung pinuhunan mo, yung pinaghirapan mo, eh mapupunta pa dun sa isa. Yeah, and...
Kasi ho, hindi tayo sanay sa prenuptial.
I was gonna say, and of course, again, what we were told then as students was, pwede ka naman mag-opt ng mag-prenuptial or, yeah, well, basically a prenuptial, but what, or they can even say, then that's where you step in and adopt a different property regime. But people don't like to do that. Eh. It's not common for us to do that. So I still would prefer that the default regime is something that gives you more protection because there's nothing that prevents you from sharing. Pero mahirap yung sapilitan.
Pwede naman hong gastahin na nila agad. Kasi yun nga ho eh, yung prenuptial kasi minsan it invites animosity eh between the balae.
Yeah.
Di ho ba? Kasi parang inaapi yung mas konti
exactly.
Yung pera.
Exactly.
Kaya okay ho yung conjugal.
Manood ka lang ng teleserye, puro ganyan ng drama noon, di ba? Hindi matutuloy ang kasal kasi nag-demand yung isa na magganito-ganito pa. Anyway, any other comments on this in particular? Okay, so we'll set that aside. We'll ask it from you, Judge, in writing. And actually, we will also be awaiting the position papers by some other professors in other universities also para we're covered. But a judge, from your experience, most of the judges and those who practice family law and professors, is that the general consensus? Or
I asked 8 of us from Bulacan, yes. I asked them, lahat ho sila agree to a conjugal partnership default.
Okay.
Mas ano ho, although in keeping with the customs ng Filipinos, yung absolute community, pero... para hindi yung protected yung kung sino man.
Mm-mm. Okay. So next is the next bills we will tackle is our Senate Bill number 228 and 2887. May isa pa pala. And a House Bill number 5675. These are bills expanding the anti-violence against women and their children law into by including electronic violence against women and children. So comments, let's start with the SWD.
We have around 7 comments on these bills, but we already submitted these to the committee,
okay,
and we noted that some of them are already noted and considered.
Okay.
So we strongly support the bill. It's just that I think in terms of
baka sa House, no? Kasi according to our secretariat, they haven't received.
Oh, yeah. House of Representatives.
No problem.
Sorry.
No problem. But generally, they're supportive. Mm-hmm. So it's in the House bill.
Yeah.
What you're saying that it's noted. Okay.
Yes, yes.
So we'll when you give us a copy, we'll compare that. It's basically improving on the...
Unless you want to discuss it?
It depends. Do we have time pa? Well, I have a ribbon cutting on my exhibit in 7 minutes.
Okay.
So, how many people are speaking on this, this bill? Why don't you hold your comments? I'll go back to you if there's still 2 more minutes for you to go through it. But you're generally supportive and it's improving it, right? So because at the end of the day, it'll go on record, but I'm curious. So let me just see what everybody else has to say, and then I'll call you again if there's a few more minutes, okay? DOJ, Attorney Castro.
Just a short, Madam Chair. We have reservations on Section 40 for the DOJ to establish and administer an address confidentiality program.
Okay.
I will have to
endorse
this
Section 14 of which bill? Kasi marami akong version. House bill. Okay.
2887, Madam Chair. We have to endorse this to WPP. Kasi po sila po yung in charge sa paggawa po ng program for this.
Yes, of course. Oo. Okay, parang
that's
witness protection. Medyo mabigat nga yun, ano? Okay. Sige. Cecil from Visayan Forum. And then
thank you, Madam. Visayan Forum fully support this amendments, especially doon sa ngayon. Marami pang trafficking victims actually was threatened by their traffickers na ipogs po yung kanilang mga pornographic things just to really to scare them. So, napaka-relevant po ito para sa amin po yung bill na ito.
Okay. Go ahead. Are you done? Okay. Ms. Bailosis, PCW.
Madam Chair, we also support the amendment to the anti-violence law, however, on the creation of a separate definition for eval as a form, we consider electronic violence as a means rather than another form. So, and most of the definitions are already covered under psychological violence. So, we are suggesting some revisions on the bills to include the definitions provided under eval in the definition on psychological violence.
Okay, kasi I also don't want to create an overlap, no? So, I can call a TWG, but if you can ahead of time submit something,
yes.
I kind of every time I amend the law, that's always my concern. Especially if sometimes there are 2 existing laws. I just want to be sure that it doesn't create more confusion. So I agree with what you're saying.
Yes, and there are also provisions that are already covered, for instance, in the anti-photovoyeurism law
exactly
and others.
That's exactly what I was whispering to my staff na, kasi sa akin yun eh.
Yes.
So I was like, I remember when I heard of this bill, I said, that's covered. So I just want to be sure that we don't duplicate. I'm very happy to expand if there are areas that have not been covered though. Yes.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Sige. Anyone else? Yes, Dr. Sena of DOH.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. The Department of Health fully supports the passage of this bill. However, we have reservations for the issuance of eval protection order with regard to the barangays, because as discussed in the Interagency Council on VAWC, it would be difficult even for the RTC to issue a protection order for eval. And we will submit an official opposition, and we will further study along with the Philippine Commission on Women with regard to the provision on issuance of protection orders.
Okay, maybe what we'll do so that it's easy for all, let's use the House of Representative version, since apparently it already includes comments that some of you agencies have already made. Para at least ano tayo, simple lang ang, you don't have to keep going, bouncing off three different versions. Is that it? Because I'll give the floor to Ms. Makabagdal for, to, so that she can also give some of her inputs.
In addition to what PCW said, we would like to recommend the adoption of the existing, what is exist, in terms of definition of terms from the RA 9262. And then we suggest that the bill, the title of the bill be changed to expanded anti-trafficking against, anti-violence against women and their children act. And then the issuance of eval protection order, we suggest that it be done by the courts, not by the barangays. Because as we know, right now, we're undergoing assessment of the functionality of barangay VAWDES, who are supposed to issue barangay protection orders. Based on assessment, our barangay officials have very low capacity in terms of fulfilling their mandate under RA 9262. So that's one. And then number two, under penalties, we recommend that penalties for eval should not be lower than what were provided under 9262, because we noted that it's lower than in the 9262. And then,
with the comments that it's a means.
Yes.
It's a means. It's the same kind of violence.
Mm-mm. And then lastly, the IRR, as a matter of looking forward, may we suggest the inclusion of a mechanism to blacklist or block any perpetrator, as well as provisions on ISP or internet service providers committing or allowing such. And then the agency responsible for the blacklisting or blocking should also be identified.
Yeah, I remember in hearings quite a few years ago, maybe with respect to the first set of hearings we had on trafficking, we invited Google and some other, I think Microsoft, and they explained to us and especially now more of them have a stronger presence here. I'd like to know what they do, because a lot of this would happen using the social media sites. So sa TWG natin, baka we could at least find out how they operate, and then for those who, the smaller entities that don't have protocols, we can require that they have, diba? Kasi kung user ka, dapat it's easy for a parent or for an individual to report and expect an automatic automatic response from the service provider or the social media the outfit that's being used. So I think let's invite them for the next coming TWG.
If we can invite Foundation for Media Alternatives, an NGO that is closely working on cyber violence.
Okay, perfect. All right, anything else? Okay, that was very productive. Thank you very much, everybody. We will be having TWGs for almost all of the bills, so I will probably see. Is that Police Superintendent, tama ba? Catherine Tamayo, tama ba? What does that stand
for? Good afternoon, ma'am. Police Senior Inspector.
Senior Inspector, okay.
Yes, ma'am.
I didn't call on you. Did you have anything to add?
Actually, ma'am, the women, I represent the Women and Children Protection Center of the Philippine National Police, and
Our comments have already been voiced out by some of our colleagues here, so we'll be filing our position paper.
So you're comfortable that, that the things that you also noted were taken
yes,
up?
Ma'am.
Okay.
Yes,
but
ma'am.
So nevertheless, you're more than we will continue to invite you.
Yes, ma'am.
On the floor, you have the experience also.
And may I add, Your Honor, that if you could also invite representatives from the anti-cybercrime group of the Philippine National Police to be a part of the
for
technical
the,
working
for
group.
The
for the input. Yes.
Okay. Sige, noted.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. The hearing is suspended because we will be having TWGs in the forthcoming weeks. Thank you.